Bethel. We give the Lord praise for yet another Thursday night hour of power. Our time to spend together praying for one another. Our time to spend together in worship. And our time to further go deeper in the Word of God and be encouraged. We thanking God for allowing us to come into His courts with praise this evening. We also thank Him for giving us another way out throughout the week, allowing us to overcome our challenges and whatever obstacles we ever had to overcome to get here this evening. We give God praise. Let's prepare our hearts for worship with our psalmist this evening, Osha Jones. We give the Lord praise for Osha. Let's begin to set the atmosphere here in our sanctuary. The word says in Isaiah chapter 40 in the New Living Translation that the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of all the earth and the heavens, the sun, the moon, and the eclipse. All right, amen. He saw that all of that was good. Isaiah 40 goes on to say that God is good, and God is able to give power to the weak and strength to the powerless. And God is God, who then, when we put our trust in Him, we can find new strength. The songwriter James Cleveland wrote, "God is the joy and strength of our life. He promised to keep us and never to leave us. He never, ever falls short of His word." So we give God honor and we give God praise, and all the glory belongs to Him. This is your call to worship, and we are in the hands of our worship leader this evening, Ms. Osha Jones.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and with all that's within me, bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Can we put our hands together and bless God? He's awesome. I serve a big God. He's done miracles, signs, and wonders. He's done great things. Come on, open up your mouth. Let's give God what is due unto Him. You open up your mouth and bless Him. You open up your mouth and bless Him. Hallelujah. Your testimony isn't my testimony. So that means your praise isn't my praise. Come on, let's press in. You entered into His gates with thanksgiving. You enter into His courts with praise. So since you're here, come on and give it to Him. Oh, I don't serve a dead God, and I will not give God a dead praise. Open up your mouth and give Him glory. Open up your mouth and give Him glory. He is a living God. He is true. He is abiding. He is everything that you need. Alpha and Omega. Beginning and the end. Come on and open up your mouth, you Bethel. Let's press into the presence. Let's press into His presence. He's an awesome, mighty God. He's worthy to be praised from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. I serve a great and mighty God. Put your hands together. Come on, I come to have church on tonight. Angels bow before saw.
Too far.
Pride and I tried. Just got deeper involved.
And
I turned it over to Jesus. And I stopped worrying about it. Gave it over to the Lord. He worked it out. Oh, yeah. Come on, Jesus.
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 Bless the Lord, everybody. Somebody open up your mouth. Let's thank God for, I'm calling my niece Osha. So grateful for her. She is young with an old soul. Y'all be seated. Justin, who from her age know about how you gonna pay your rent? All your money spent. Baby need a pair of shoes. I adore her. Thank you, Osha, and to your team. Come on, let's thank God for them spending Thursday night, her and her family and her team. So tonight, speak, Lord. Make us a better people because we're here. Cause us not to just be here out of routine, but because we truly desire a closer walk with you. We don't deserve to be in your presence. But we're grateful that you love us enough to allow us to study your holy word. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's a new series on Netflix, not Tubi. Y'all know Tubi is my favorite channel. Rock with Tubi all night long. Fake blood and everything. Netflix. And I was watching a little bit of it, and it's called Unlocked. Just came out. I don't know the results of it, so I'm not claiming that this works, but this is what interested me. I watch a lot of, my undergrad was in criminal justice, and so I've always kind of been amazed about the criminal justice system, always kind of been involved. I got a job in prison when I got out of the Air Force. So I was in Texas. I said I was never coming back to Buffalo, like a few of y'all did. When I got out, I said, I ain't never, ever gonna be in snow again. So I got a job with the Texas Department of Corrections. And I never went to work, and I never got trained because I start thinking about the call of those who work in jails. They're in jail, too. But this series called Unlocked is doing an experiment in which the prison right now in, I think it's Little Rock, they're locked down 23 hours and come out for one. And when they get out for one, they were showing how they start fighting and how they're all built up and angry. And they're interviewing people. And I saw one fight, which they just, when they get out for the hour, they just go bonkers. So this black sheriff has made a decision that he's going to do this experiment in which he's unlocking the doors in one of the pods. And he says to his deputies, if we treat them like people, maybe they'll act like people. And he talks about them, and I'm only at the first episode, so I haven't even got to the point of it being unlocked. So I'm telling you this, and the experiment may have failed, but here's the only reason I'm telling you, because at the end of the day, what the hope was is that they would not fight and that they would not tear each other apart to the place where they had no community, and then that you had to only let them out for 1 hour. I want to suggest to you today that this place where we're at, and Lord, teach us to pray, is that sometime believers act worse than prisoners. And it's almost like, and I thought about it as I was looking at a portion of this earlier today, it's almost like we're only together an hour, we're only together a few hours, and maybe because people are locked up so much in their mind and in their time and in their personal lives, that when we get together, oh boy, it's going to get it. Now, everybody ain't going to like this teaching because it's going to push you to do something beyond what you want to do. Now, this front row, I ain't talking to. I ain't talking to Mary Swain about this. She already mastered it. But for some of us, I want you to put in your mind, you ain't going to like this, one person that is difficult for you to either forgive or get along with. You got it? You got it right there? You know the name, don't you? The face came to you and you got an attitude. Because you're like, you triggering some stuff. I ain't come here to be triggered. But I want to show you this in the model prayer, Matthew chapter 6, verse number 12, where we're at today. I'm going to push you by the word of God into a more peaceful life. I'm going to push you by the word of God, not by preaching, by the word of God into a more peaceful life. I ain't say happy life because happiness comes and goes. I'm talking about even when you ain't happy, being peaceful. Matthew 6, 12, I'm going to King James Version. Mama Joseph.
And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
New Living Translation.
And forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sin against us.
Notice that the request for forgiveness comes after the request for daily bread, but together. Okay, let me do it again. Comes together. How do you know? Because it says, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our... Notice it has the word and, which is connected to the daily bread. So Jesus is showing what you need daily are two things. You need me to provide for you. I want you to want me to provide for you. But I also want you to allow me to forgive you as you forgive others. Stay with me, stay with me, stay with me. Give us this day our daily bread. The word and is used to connect separate clauses that have logical connection. What's logical about asking God to give me food and asking him to give me forgiveness? Because I need it on a daily basis. I need it on a daily basis. I need God. I cannot live without air, without water. I cannot live without those two things. I cannot live. Eventually, you need food in your body. Give us this day our daily bread. Give me what I need. And it's not just talking about physical. We already been through that. Give me what I need this day. But then he puts the and. So a lot of people like to ask God for stuff, but don't want to ask him for forgiveness, and definitely don't want to forgive nobody else. Okay, I'm going to help somebody right now. God, give me. God, I need. And God says, I'm going to connect what you need with how you forgive, And I'm going to connect how you forgive with how I forgive you. And let me help you. This is not a one-for-one situation. This is not a mathematical equation in which you say, okay, God, I sinned one time, but I forgave one time, so we even. No. This is about creating an atmosphere in your life for forgiveness like God forgives. Let me do it again. This, because whether you get mad at me, whether you're watching, whether you cut off TV, whether you, whatever it is, I'm still going to say it, because there are some people who are bitter all of their lives. Praise team up there trying to get you to have some joy. You ain't going to have no joy because you bitter. You was bitter when you walked in. You're going to be bitter when you walk out. You bitter on your job. You bitter at home. You bitter in the grocery store. My goodness. Can't even experience God to the fullness because we want him to give us our daily bread. This is what I tell people all the time. I have no enemies. Now, there might be people who don't like me, but I live a life that I don't care what you did to me. I can't. Life is too short to be. I'm trying to help somebody. Your life is too short to have a list of enemies and be going through it. God, I can't stand this one. I can't stand that one. I can't stand that. I hate this one. At the end of the day. Can I preach and teach in here? Forgive us our debts. The other one says, forgive our sins in the New Living Translation. And this is about the grace of God. Now, if we say that we worship a God of grace, where is grace in the believer? We love to do all this and do all this, do all of this. But where is the love and the grace that God has given us to give to somebody else? Am I teaching it here tonight? I'm going to teach it whether you like it or not. So I want to deal with this word forgive, and then we're going to push hard. We're going to push hard. The word forgive in the Greek here means to let go, leave alone, release, liberation. You go study for yourself. I promise you I did the study. Let me read it again. Because when we talk about forgiving, it says, let it go. Leave it. Release it. Forgive it. Liberate. Okay, y'all with me tonight? First, but most important thing to note about this scripture, I just told you that it's not a one-for-one. What many believers intended, as a guy by the name of Bob Hostetler writes, forgive us is the same way we forgive others. He said it can be understood as a suggestion that our forgiveness of others will set the tone for the Father's forgiveness of us. Now, every perfect person in here doesn't need this. You don't need to learn this lesson. That's because you are perfect, you are upright, you never make any bad choice. You just a cat's meow. But for the 98% of us who will admit we need God's forgiveness at times in our lives, how can you ask him for forgiveness when you can't forgive somebody else? We are some grudge holders, hold on to the past, always talking about what somebody did to me. That happened 20 years ago, and you still don't talk to them in church. Still won't work with them in ministry and wonder why the devil gets the victory in our worship and in our lives because we are missing this component. And I don't care how much I preach it. The people don't want to hear it. They done already signed off. They already in the kitchen. They like, oh no, he ain't got no miracle sermon. He ain't got no blessed oil. You wouldn't need as much blessed oil if you let some stuff go. Some folk need more blessed oil than other people because you still bitter and you think God is going to just bring you out of your bitterness. I wish I had a couple witnesses in here who would admit that one of the things you needed deliverance from God was being bitter and being hateful and holding on to stuff until you almost crushes you. Stay with me. I'm almost gone. Here's a phrase I want you to remember. We are not perfect, so forgive others as you want to be forgiven. You are not perfect. Stop walking around like you that person. Stop walking around like you, oh, I'm the perfect one. Everybody else has done me wrong. No, I have never done anybody else wrong. Oh, the Bible says you're a liar. The Bible, not Darius. Somebody say the Bible said it. The Bible said it. Now, we're going to get into some Bible. I'm going to give you more than what you even want. But let me tell you this. The way God forgives, because that's what he's trying to do, is pattern our forgiveness after the way he forgives. He forgives among many ways, but let me give you three to just take you home. One, he forgives quickly. I'm going to show you a word. Two, he forgives fully. And three, he forgives repeatedly. Oh, let me do it. Let go. If we could get this, I forgive quickly. No, some folk want you to come, beg them, lay on the ground, grovel at their feet. But if you're a believer, I just believe in this Bible. You're a believer and you got an art with another believer. The Bible say, go to that believer. Go to that believer. If that person admits, hey, you know what? We got off to a bad start. You got people supposed to be believers. They'll just keep it going. I know we got off to a bad start. And then call somebody else and call somebody. And do you know who the happiest person is about it? The enemy. I'm going to show you word in a minute about it. If you just stay with me. I want to show you some of the standards of how God forgives and ask yourself, do I forgive the same way? Go to 1 John chapter 1, verse number 9. I want to show you some of the standards. What does it say?
If we confess our sins.
That means if we initiate it. If we confess our sins, what?
He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins.
And to do what?
And to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
What word is there? All. I want you to notice that word. He cleanses us from all unrighteousness because what did I tell you? He does it fully. Now, almost everybody in here, some of you too young, you ain't got there yet, has somebody who continually offends you. And I know 10 of y'all are at the end of your rope. You like, I let it go in May. I let it go in June. But I ain't taking this in July. Right? And that's what the enemy wants. He wants you to get to the point where you go like, I ain't taking this no more. I ain't going to forgive you no more. I ain't going to be cool with you no more. I ain't going to do this no more. And then what he wants you to do is spread the fire. Spread the fire. Spread the fire. How do I spread? Spread the fire. Spread the fire. When God forgives, he forgives all. Y'all with me tonight? He forgives all. He forgives all. Come on, we going to stay in this word. If we confess our sins, he is faithful. If we go to him, God fully and quickly forgives. Go to Psalms. I'm all over, but you're going to have plenty of word to go home and read tonight if you get an attitude. You're going to be like, let me go back to my Bible study. Let me go back to my Bible study. I want to prove that it's off. Psalms 103:12, although it's a psalm, it still has truth. Read.
He has removed our sins as far from us as the east is from the west. The Lord is like a father to his children, tender and compassionate to those who fear him. For he knows how weak we are. He remembers we are only dust.
God knew we were dirty when he made us.
That's why we needed his breath in us to make us living beings. But he knows us. He knew Adam. He knew Eve. He knew your grandmother, your grandfather, your great, your mother. Oh, don't talk about my family. Don't talk. Your grandmother had faults. My grandmother had faults. My grandfather had faults. My aunts, my uncles, me, you, the person next to you. As a matter of fact, let's just get this house in order. For some, those of you who think you're so good, the rest of us who know that if it had not been for God forgiving us, I just need you to look down your row and go, we all in the boat together. We all in this boat, baby. We all in this boat. That's why that's why some of our praise ought to be for the fact that he still forgives. Whoo! Forgives all, forgives all, forgives all, forget. If God forgave you, forgive you. Okay, let me do it again. Let me do it again. Let me do it again. If God forgave you, forgive yourself. I wish somebody would holler and just say, I'm forgiving myself. I'm getting my life. I know most of us don't want to hear this, but there is no limit on how often you should forgive. I'm messing with you tonight. Prove it to me. Matthew chapter 18. Verse 21, and if you're a good mathematician, stay with us because I'm going to mess up your math. Read.
Then Peter came to him and asked, Lord, how often should I forgive someone who sins against me? Seven times? No, not seven times, Jesus replied, but 70 times seven.
Now listen, if you're sitting around with an ink pad writing down how many times somebody done gone against you, you done already missed the point. What he's saying is, it is endless. It is endless. Listen, I'm trying to teach you tonight why my blood pressure is low. Some of y'all got high blood pressure, and it ain't because of, some of it's because of stress. And you counting. Do it one more time. Just do it one more time. Say it one more time. Then you got some people in here, they'll tell you that their blood pressure is low. Now, your blood pressure, you might still not be stressed to her, but I think you get the point for you deep folks. At the end of the day, there are some people who will tell you in here right now they're living a peaceful life because they're not counting offenses. Who am I talking to in here? Okay, let me do it another way. Because although you've been offended, God is still blessing you. I don't know who I'm talking to in here right now, but I dare you to get it. He's still making a way in your life, and God is still, am I talking to anybody in here? When you learn how to forgive others, there is a freedom that occurs. There is a liberation that occurs. There is a peace that occurs. And it passes all understanding. But I wish for you tonight, I pray for somebody tonight, for you to sleep well. Because you can get bound up in your head.
I feel like teaching tonight. I'm praying.
7 No, not even, not seven, no, but 70 times seven. Now, God, you're making this worse for me tonight. Because I was good being angry. It felt good being bitter. It felt good talking about it. It felt good. It felt good. But now you telling me by your word that I have a responsibility and you put it in your model prayer. From the Old Testament to the New Testament, we see the same thing. So let me back you up to the Old Testament. Micah, just go to the index. Just go to the index. You over there. I would be doing the same. I'm close. Micah chapter 7, verse number 18. Read.
Where is another God like you who pardons the guilt of the remnant? Overlooking the sins of his special people. You will not stay angry with your people forever because you delight in showing unfailing love.
Just somebody holler, don't stay angry. Ooh. Okay, make it personal. Just somebody holler, I'm not going to stay angry. Ooh, I feel the Holy Ghost in here tonight. I'm not going to stay angry. I'm not, let me, come on, say it one more time. Because I'm not going to stay angry because God doesn't stay angry with me. I am not going to stay. Where are the saints? Where are the believers that let go and are free? You can't preach and not let go. You can't sing and not let go. You can't minister and not let go. You can't be in peace and not let go, or else you will carry the burdens of your past and what everybody has done on your back so much that you cannot run and not be weary. You cannot talk in here. Is there anybody in here tonight getting ready to let go? It ain't for everybody. Like I said, it ain't for everybody because some of y'all didn't learn this already. So it's just a reminder in your life. But a few people in here right now, you need this tonight. You need it tonight. And I just need the ones who need it tonight to holler back at me as loud as you can and just, I need it tonight. It's going to keep some of y'all out of jail, and it's going to keep some of y'all out of hell. I don't know who I'm talking to, but you are still a free man or woman because you learned to forgive. You learn to forgive. You learn, and you still save because you learn to forgive. You must understand this. The enemy never wants you to forgive. And that's why when you forgive, you'll know who's connected to God, who's around you. Because if they're connected to God, they will understand why you forgive. And if they're not connected to God, they will encourage you not to forgive by reminding you of what somebody else did against you. Am I preaching and teaching in here? So they go, I can't believe you're going to forgive them. You know, oh, maybe you don't know this, and maybe you don't know that, and maybe you don't know this, and maybe you don't, and maybe you do. But whether you know it or whether you don't, when you get to the point of forgiving, what you're saying is, I'm leaving it right there where it was. Am I talking in here? I'm leaving it. What's the definition? Let it go. Y'all seen that commercial? This is my favorite commercial on right now, my favorite, where it's people middle age, and it's the insurance commercial, and it says, try not to be like your parents. Y'all seen that? That's my favorite. I love that commercial. And the guy had and I'm like this. This is the bad thing. I put up on social media, it got over 8,000 views. A bottle of ragu. 8,000 people looked at it in a day. And I said, and I was serious, I don't know what to do with this bottle. It's empty. So I was like, I could take it down to my tool room. I could put some nails in it. I could use it as I got 100 glasses. I could put some ice in it in the summertime, sit outside. I was stressing. And then somebody simply said this, let it go. I just let it go. I'm taking out the garbage, still going, but I could use this bottle. I know I ain't got no room in my cabinet. I'm preaching right now, whether you know it. I ain't got no room in my cabinet for a leftover bottle of ragu when I got good glasses in the cabinet. I don't know about you. I like my stuff organized. I like all my big glasses with the big glasses, then the medium glasses with the medium glasses, then the juice glasses with the juice glass. Why am I going to add a random piece of glass that I don't really need? I got enough of those in the basement. There are times that you are adding what is done, what should be done, when you could be recycling that and let it have a new life. Oh, I feel like preaching with 10 people. Is there anybody in here who is learning how to just let it go? I wish you were sitting next to the right one. You look, if you know him, if you came with him, talk to him. If you don't know him, don't mess with him. If you know him, look at him and say, let it go. I like that commercial. That man had them car rugs. And the man said, do you still own that car?
And the man said, no. He said, throw that stuff out. How many times do we hold on to something that we need to let go? How many smiles have we lost in our life because we got our face all tuned up? I ain't talking to everybody. I told you it's written all on your face. You come in a certain place, you all happy. You see something, you own somebody, you own that. And now you done went from this to, you done missed the smile. Why are you going to miss a minute of joy when you needed to let that ragu go? Will you help me preach and just tell somebody, let the ragu go, let the ragu go. The enemy never wants you to let it go. Go to 1 Corinthians 1 and 10. Ooh, your life is going to be better. Our lives will be better. 1 Corinthians 1 and 10. What does it say?
I appeal to you, dear brothers and sisters, by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ.
To do what?
To live in harmony with each other.
Get along. Harmony. Do you know what harmony is? Harmony doesn't mean everybody sings the same note. Everybody's alto in harmony is unison. He says live in harmony. You're a little different than somebody else. Somebody else a little different than somebody else. Know your note. Okay, let me do it again. The problem is you got too many altos trying to sing the soprano. Too many tenors trying to be the alto. When you learn your note, you just sing your note. I know my note, and I know what note I can't get. I'm a tenor. Ain't no sense me trying to sing soprano or tell sopranos how to sing. Know your note. Know who you are. Live in harmony. Let's at least be on the same page for whatever music we singing. Am I preaching in here tonight? You got people that, you know, I grew up directing choirs. I'm a church boy, I'm a church boy. That's what I came up. And so at the end of the day, I grew up directing choirs. And it would always be somebody ain't come to rehearsal. Show up on singing day. Now, you trying to put them in the back, but that's the one always want to be in the front, and they don't know they know. And now you got to surround them with other folk who know they know. That's the one everybody wearing green, they come in black. Bible says, live in harmony. Can I tell you the people who don't want to live in harmony? Many times, it's the people who want to get attention in the church because they ain't getting attention nowhere else. Y'all don't get mad at me. I've been doing this too long not to tell the truth. When you secure in who you are, you don't depend on nothing else for you to get attention, because as long as God pays me attention, God, if you pay attention to me, I'm going to be all right. I don't need to be the one to stand out. I don't need to be the one to go against the rule. I don't need to be the one to try to justify why I'm not going to know my note, why I ain't going to work in harmony, why I ain't going to participate with nobody else. Only one who is laughing at the church is the devil. He like, yes, ooh, good, good, good. They hate each other. They're evil. They're mean. And then they want to talk about hallelujah. I'm trying to preach, Ron. I'm trying to teach. You can't say hallelujah out of the same mouth and in the same sentence and then cuss me out. At least wait till later. I'm trying to deal with this. Because I want our lives to be better. I want ministry to be more effective. But you can't have effective ministry with people holding grudges. And I mean literally. I've been in this 30 years at this church. I've been in it since I was a kid as a preacher. And what I've seen sometimes is more hate with the believers than in the wrestling ring. Muhammad Ali could get along with who he boxed afterward. They talked stuff all the way up to the boxer. Boom, 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 it's over. Hey, they all made their money, right? We watch football. They be talking mess, and they walk away with their money. They $20 million. We broke sometime. Talking about, Lord, make a way. Ain't nobody got nothing but hate. I came to turn that around tonight, at least in your life. Because God blesses those who forgive, and he forgives those who forgive. And when he forgives, he wipes the slate clean. I'm talking about a better relationship with God. And you can't have a better relationship with God if you can't get along with man. How can you love me who you can't see? I wish I had a witness in here. The only one I'm mad at is the devil. Y'all with me tonight? I only got a couple more notes. To live in harmony with each other. Read.
Let there be no divisions in the church.
Stop right there. Let's just soak it in. Now, let me be clear. All of us have our people who we get along with. That's not against the word of God. But getting along shouldn't cause division. So the math, it's okay with addition. Your group ought to be creating addition. If we together, we gonna add to this thing. But when what you're doing is causing division, separating, that's what that word means in that sense. When you are causing separation, because there's some folk. We used to have, when I first got here, and, you know, churches go through the church general, you know, goes through different seasons. They used to have small group studies that you did at home. I bought into that. I was like, yeah. You can have a Bible study, and you can have a Bible study, and you can have a Bible study. Before I knew it, there were four different True Bethels. Because everybody wanted to create and then be the junior pastor of Living Room Baptist Church and then tell their group why they shouldn't. Well, you know, the pastor said this, but this is what I believe in. And it causes division. I don't know if I'm going to get to do it this year because I don't have it on the schedule, but earlier when I was studying, I found the 12 major religions and the differences of them, and the differences of all Christian, but all created mainly because of division. I believe the body of Christ is the real body of Christ. I believe it's a symbol of the body of Christ. I believe you just got to speak in tongues. I don't believe you got to speak in tongues. I believe that you don't have to baptize. I believe you can sprinkle divisions. I've chose not to participate in those divisions. So I don't argue. I teach what I believe. I'll share what I believe. I ain't arguing with you. And I'm not putting you in hell because I don't have keys to heaven or hell. So we may differ in some belief, but when it's starting to divide the body of Christ, the unfortunate part is a lot of folk who need to hear this, they already signed off, and they're going to be here Sunday, looking and acting mean. But this is what I learned. If you make them the anomaly, make them the ones that, that ain't how we are. It's like a wart. They're either going to fall off or they just ain't going to bother you no more. That's what you got to do in your life. Everybody, you want to be mean? Be mean. But in the body of Christ, there's got to be somebody who loves. I'm right on time. 7 minutes.
Go ahead, Mama Joyce.
Rather, be of one mind, united in thought and purpose. For some members of Chloe's household have told me about your quarrels, my dear brothers and sisters.
So this ain't new. Paul is writing to the church of Corinth. He said, some folk done already narked on y'all and told that some of y'all can't get along. So what I love about Paul in his letter writing is Paul says, and you remember Paul. Paul ain't have the best history, but what he was saying is, as far as the church of God, what I'm not gonna do is ignore the quarrels, the division, trying to get the work done. I know you ain't gonna like me for this. I know you're gonna think I'm reaching. We have been taught not to like each other. It goes back to how the majority of us in this room, our ancestors arrived here. And so even our children sometimes feel like the way to get across their message is to be, you know, screw faced and be mean and get my way, get my thought across. And so we teach the same thing. And at the end of the day, what's suffering is we as a people, and especially is we as believers.
Come on, Bishop.
Let me do it again. We as a people, and we as believers. If we teach more harmony, that's why I love the restorative justice model in the schools, in which two kids get into it, and they sit down, right? And they get them to work it out. Not fight it out. And y'all can get mad at me who are watching if you want to, but I said this a million times. I think adults who record children fighting and put it out there should be arrested. Am I teaching for anybody in here tonight? What happens if we show our children the love of Christ by being in harmony with one another? Read the scripture, Mama Joyce, because I'm down to my five minutes.
Dear brothers and sisters, I close my letter with these.
We're in 2 Corinthians 13 and 11. Read.
I close this letter with these last words. Be joyful. Grow to maturity.
Grow up. There are grown folks still acting like little kids. Fighting over parking spaces. I'm trying to teach you. It's quiet in here tonight. Can I say this in all love? Because we love to blame the pastor for growth spurts or whatever, or downturns. What I've learned in my 30 years of pastoring is that there are some people who almost pride themselves in running other people away.
Come on, Bishop.
There are some leaders that just don't know how to talk to people, who don't know how to forgive people. They've got to be the anomaly. There are some people that are so stuck on themselves that they don't know how to be patient and kind and loving. And then we wonder why people out there don't want to come in here. Because at least if I go to see, what was the last concert, the big one? Drake. They're going to give me a ticket. I'm going to know where I'm sitting. I know if I can bring in beer or not. And everybody on my row, we all going to be, I don't even know what Drake sing, but rah, 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 rah. Yeah, everybody in the row going to be, rah, 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 rah. Because everybody went there with a purpose. The problem sometimes in the church, too many people come with an agenda. Oh God, I'm in trouble tonight.
I'm in trouble. I'm going to have to join your church. I'm in trouble tonight. I'm in trouble tonight. There are too many people who come to the church with an agenda and not with a purpose to be on one accord. God, whatever you're going to do in the next hour. Let me tell you how I know. Because there are some people who already come even into his worship with a set of how they want worship to go for them. So that if God then shifts the service and does what he wants to do, then we start going, I ain't getting nothing today. You didn't get anything because you didn't want to give anything because you came in with your own agenda. You came in with the God bless me agenda, God do for me agenda. God, I want the pastor to preach for 14 minutes and 30 seconds, and if he goes over, oh Lord, that's all you talk about. I want the certain person to sing on Sunday, and if they know, oh Lord, my singer ain't there. You should have went to a Drake concert. Because when you enter in, it becomes about the will of God. And if we would stop being so unforgiving and mean and hateful and bossy, like church is communism. That ain't of God.
Oh, it's quiet in here tonight. I ain't got a whole lot of amens. I got one more minute. Go to Colossians 3 and 14.
Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony.
Look what brings us together. Because there are two things, two big Bible themes you should never forget. Love and forgiveness. The way you bind yourself together is not by denomination. It is by love. It is by love. And when you bind yourself by love, you can get along with people that other people say you should not. We used to sing a song, his banner over me is love. His banner over me ain't Baptist. Banner over me ain't Kojic. His banner over me ain't Roman, Catholic, Lutheran. His banner over me over is not Episcopalian and Anglican. It's none of that. His banner over me is love. If you want to see me, don't see my denomination. See my heart and my love for everybody else. Am I preaching in here tonight? If they can see your love, then they can hear your message. But if they can't see your love, they can't hear you, because all they see is you, and they need to see God, and they need to see God more than they see you, because when they see that you love them, that I came to tell you, I'm a living witness. Folk will love you when you love them, and some folk won't, but it's all right as long as you are not the one who is doing the hating and the unforgiving. Can we read this? It's love. Read.
And we're
getting ready to go.
Mm-hmm. Let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are called to live in peace.
Now, I'm going rapid fire. Matthew 6:14. I won't pause.
If you forgive those who sin against you, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive your sins.
Hebrews 8:12.
And I will forgive your wickedness, and I will never again remember their sins.
Ephesians 4:31.
Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. Instead, be kind to each other.
Read.
Tenderhearted.
Read.
Forgiving one another.
Read.
Just as God, through Christ, has forgiven you.
Mark 11:24.
I tell you, you can pray for anything, and if you believe that you've received it, it will be yours. But when you are praying.
But when you are praying, read.
First, forgive anyone.
But when you are praying, first. Forgive anyone. When you are praying, first forgive anyone. Read, Mama Joyce.
You are holding a grudge against.
Yes.
So that your Father in heaven will forgive your sins too.
Luke 6:37.
Judge not, and ye shall not be judged. Condemn not, and ye shall not be condemned. Forgive, and ye shall be forgiven.
38. Read verse 38.
Give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, and shaken together, and running over, shall men give into your bosoms. For with the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you.
Luke 23:34, what did Jesus say?
Then Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they, and what they parted, then they parted his raiment and lots.
Father, forgive them.
For they know not.
for they know not what they do. I need somebody to jump up and just holler, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Now clap your hands with peace. Somebody clap your hands and thank God. Thank God you're being liberated. Thank God you're being set free. Thank God no more chains holding you. Is there anybody here tonight feeling freer than you ever have? Is there anybody here tonight knows there's a freedom of forgiveness? Knows there is a liberation of forgiveness that can thank God tonight. I'm not holding grudges. I'm not holding grudges. But I'm going to do like the word says. I'm going to let it go. I'm going to leave it there. And then what are you going to do? I'm going to keep going forward. Is there anybody here tonight that feels free? Is there anybody here tonight that feels better? Is there anybody here tonight that is leaving it right where it was? I need you to open up your free mouth and let God know, I can forgive others because you have forgiven me. I need the ones who know that God has forgiven you to open up your mouth and thank God that he's forgiven you. When I was sinking deep in sin, far the peaceful shore, deeply strained within. Is there anybody who knows that love lifted you? Because he loves you, he lifted you. Because he loves you, he lifted you. Because he loves you, he lifted you. And there's a peace in knowing that God doesn't treat you like man does, but God loves you. Is there anybody here tonight that knows he loves you and you love him? I love the Lord. He heard my cry and pitied every groan. Long as I live and troubles rise, I'll hasten.